Okay. So today we are going to continue on algorithms and functions at the same time. One of the problems that we always teach and face with in computing is sorting. When you have two things, one of them is bigger, one of them is smaller. One of them is starting with lower value of the letters, such as A comes before B. So if a person has a name starting with A, when you sort, so A should come first, then the person with the name starting B. So that is another, so alphabetical sorting. Buyurun. Bana daha yakın. Tamam. Kolay gelsin. Bakalım. 112 olunca ya TÜBİTAK ya bakanlık ya da şey ikinci kattaki su makinesinin filtresi su ihtiyacınız olduğunda şişelerinizi, termoslarınızı bir üst kattaki makineden doldurabilirsiniz. So, general problem is, you have items. The idea is to sort these elements. These could be numbers, these could be letters, names, whatever. So, sorting problem is ordering problem, from big to small, small to big, whatever. Also, there is another problem, such as searching problem. Searching means you have an element, for example, U in your hand. The problem becomes checking whether there is an element named similar to, same as the one we are interested in a given list. So apparently, there is one. So this is a searching algorithm. Sorting problems, adding, deleting, these kind of problems are fundamental problems of computer science. And applications are a lot, like when you are searching something in Google, there are a lot of things going on at the background. So it has to be done very quickly. It has to be correct and less costly. The cost of the operation, in terms of computation, to Google should be minimal, so that the advertisement money should be as cheap as possible for the Google to operate. We have a person named Polya. They have Sonnen-Polya theorem as well. So it says you need to understand the problem before starting to solve it. If you, as I said yesterday, in order to solve a problem, you need to understand the problem. That is the fundamental principle of philosophy and early times of science. So you need to describe, understand, then solve. If you cannot describe the problem, you cannot solve it. So you have to understand it. Second, devise, generate a plan for solving the problem. So make a plan. That is kind of an algorithm. So make a plan. Second, Third, do the plan. Action. Do the plan. Four, evaluate the solution for accuracy and its potential as a tool for solving other problems. So this is basically a scientific way of working. Principles of science. Principles of scientific experiments. So first understand, then generate a solution, implement the solution, test the solution so that it is correct and it is generalizable for similar problems. For example, you may have three elements in the list, B, A, C, right? If I want you to sort it, what would you do? Just replace these two, right? You have A, B, C. Is that clear? So your algorithm says, replace the first two elements. Swap. Is this an algorithm for sorting? No. But it solves my special case. So in certain times, solving special case does not mean that it is generalizable. In this case, it is not generalizable. It is not the algorithm, the special case solution. So a good algorithm should be generalizable in order to be called as an algorithm. This is the solution for the particular case. Swap, then it is done. But it is done only for this example, not in general. There are other cases, not in sorting, in everyday problems, such as making Erasmus agreement with another university. There is an algorithm. You should write and then make an agreement, sign the agreement. Agreement will be signed by the rector's office, etc. So there is a procedure. Sometimes those people are friend of some faculty or friend of a person. So some procedures may not be implemented, but that doesn't mean that it is going to be an algorithm. The algorithm should be formal, generalizable. So for the program development, developing programs, you will understand the problem, get the idea of how an algorithmic function solve the problem. I am going to swap these and move to the other one. I'm going to iterate, etc. So then formulate the algorithm and represent it as a program. Evaluate the solution for accuracy and its potential as a tool for solving other problems. So make sure that it's okay. So test it with certain different inputs. Testing is usually considered as a bottom level job. It is usually seen as bottom level job, junior job, by engineers like you. On the other hand, it is very important and it must be done by experienced people, such as automobile testing is done by experienced drivers, racing drivers, so that they understand the problems with the car that is being manufactured. An apprentice driver, a beginner driver, cannot understand the problems in a new BMW car. In order to test those things, very experienced old age drivers are selected and they drive accordingly. because they have certain ability to, they have knowledge accumulation. Therefore, in the testing of the programs, it is quite important, although in the industry it is regarded as a beginner job. Actually, it is not, because in the testing, you need to understand the problems. So in order to understand the problems, you need to understand whole behavior of how things are organized so that you provide certain inputs and it is going to fail. That requires a lot of knowledge. It is one mistake done by the industry that beginner people in the companies are usually given to testing in the software companies. I understand them, because if we expect development from the new engineers, they also have limitations in their abilities. They need to understand the company. They need to understand the program structure in the company. So they need to spend some time in testing. Fine, but it should be supported by also experienced people. So testing is important. Evaluation. Otherwise, you believe that my program is good. My program is good. You are the one who cannot use it to user. Okay. So what is the meaning of getting foot in the door? That's an American idiom. To start finding a solution. If you put your foot in the door, you can prevent that it is going to close on you. So you will find additional ways to enter by putting your foot first. You can enter. So to tackle how do you start to develop an idea about sorting? You have to, the sorted one, the result is like this, final position. So sometimes, usually, you start from the other end. You look at the result, a potential result, a simple result, and say that this is going to be the result. So start thinking that, how am I going to achieve to this solution from the given initial condition? Typically, you are going to replace elements in this case. In other cases, you are going to count something. You are going to erase, add, subtract something. So by looking at this potential solution, you develop your strategy, initial strategy, because you expect the result in certain way. Some problems do not allow that. You cannot know the result. Even an example is not known. So in that case, you will try to understand the principles, and you will guide yourself based on the principles of the problem. How am I going to reduce inflation? A complicated problem, but you have to start from somewhere. So ideally, one strategy is make a final final case, final example. Describe the final example that you want to reach. You want to reach to a state where inflation rate is something and the savings in the banks are at set at certain amount and GDP is at certain amount. So that is my final goal. So in order to achieve that goal, which parameters I need to play with should be discussed and implemented based on theories, of course. Sometimes the problem is too complicated, like this example. So you can reduce the problem into a simpler one. If you reduce the problem to a simpler one, like instead of dealing with the country's budget, you can deal with the family budget. So develop a model relating to family budget, solve the problem in the family budget, then expand your solution to a bigger problem. It is valid for everything. For example, if you are going to make an application for whole university, that might sound complicated for the student records, etc. Start doing something with one class of students. So if you can solve the problem in one class of students, certain interesting problem, then you can expand your solution with additional variables to the university or to the Milli Eğitim Bakanlığı, with YÖK, etc. So try to reduce the problem first by eliminating additional constraints and variables. That is one method, relaxation. Solve an easier problem. Another way is divide the problem. If the problem is too complicated, you have two choices. It is actually, we discussed it yesterday. It is actually a strategy in university entrance exams and other high school exams as well. The problem seems too complicated, but you understand it somehow, part of it. So if you understand part of it, try to solve part of it. Maybe you will understand better if you solve part of it. So try to calculate some doable parts. On the way, you may find solution to additional parts. Or once you do one part of the problem, then later you can do the second part of the problem. And if you finish all the parts of the problem, then the problem will be solved. Such as, again, the inflation is the popular topic today in the country. So there are many reasons of the inflation. So try to address each of them separately and combine the results. Because as a whole, it might be too complicated to write a solution. Okay. That is called as bottom-up methodology. For example, when you are developing a web page, you are developing, for example, hepsiburada.com. It might seem too complicated. So try to do shopping basket. If you are finished with shopping basket, try to make product display. Try to make campaigns. Try to make coupons. So solve the problem individually. Then combine the results. Sometimes basic solutions provide some certain accuracy. Later, you can improve it. You can improve by speed or you can improve accuracy. You make calculations about, you can estimate, write a program to estimate how many students in the class by looking at a camera, an artificial intelligence algorithm will detect people in this classroom and give me the number of students in real time, for example, so that the rector's office always can say there are 1,200 students listening lectures in the class right now, real time. That's a project. So how am I going to determine? I'm going to count heads. But if you are at the back, for example, like that guy, not listening to me, him. So the algorithm will fail because the camera cannot see him. Okay. So if you can improve your algorithm to count not only faces but also hair, then the algorithm will function better. Maybe they are bald. Yes, kel olabilirler. So there is always improvement, accuracy improvement. So start with basic algorithm. You approach to some solution, then you can improve your solution, accuracy of the solution. That is also a way of generating algorithms. If you start your algorithms by saying that a person might be bald, then you cannot move. For example, you decided that you want to open a bakery store in Gebze. Your friend says, but there is another bakery in the other side. But how are you going to deal with the municipality? How are you going to deal with the workers, etc.? So there are a lot of reasons that prevents you from doing that job. If you take those into account at the beginning, you cannot move forward. So try to find the simple solution. Try to find the basic solution first. Then address those problems. Address problems with the municipality. Address problems with the other worker conditions, etc. later. That's an idea. Unfortunately, that is not correct all the time, because if it is not a proper place, if it is not a legitimate place, for example, you have to take those preconditions into account, of course. Sometimes the problem cannot be solved. Some problems cannot be solved. So if you are trying to solve problems that cannot be solved, that's a that may sound like you have to dream of it before you implement it kind of approach, but you have to dream something legitimate. Dreaming unlegitimate things, undoable things, is not considered as creative acts. We should consider them as ridiculous acts, because it might be proved that it is undoable. So if it is proven that it is undoable due to certain theoretical constraints, such as sorting in a certain amount of time, sorting n number in a certain given time, if it is proven that it is undoable, then don't dream of that solution. You cannot dream. Dreaming is usually related with being less educated. Hani diyorlar ya, öğrencilerin önünü tıkama, işte ben aslında şey yapmıştım da, bütün Türkiye'yi kurtaracak enerji üreten makine yapmıştım da TÜBİTAK beni kapıdan kovdu. Because it can't be done. You are the one who are uneducated to comprehend that problem. So therefore, not all problems are solvable. In order to understand the problem and in order to tackle the problem, try to reduce it to a simpler form, so that simple case can be understood then you can expand your solution. For example, when you are doing sorting, three numbers may not be enough. 30 is too much. Too much. Because there will be a lot of repetitions in the exam. So make it 5. So it's a big enough to represent main issue, but small enough so that I can think about it and I can play with it manually in the development phase of the algorithm. One problem to think, everybody should think now. A person A is charged with the task of determining the ages of B. B's three children. B tells A that this is B's children. And there is A. B tells A that the product of three children's age, X, Y, Z. Product of three children's ages is 36. X times Y times Z is 36. A replies that another clue is required. Ek hok sorusu var ya. Tutmuyor. So A replies that give me another clue. I cannot solve it. There are many possibilities. Also the ages are integers. 1.5 and 2 doesn't make 3. So integer ages. B tells A that some of the children's ages. Sum is given. A replies that another clue is needed. From linear algebra, you will learn if we have three unknowns, you need three equations. So X plus Y plus Z is known. But A replies another one. B tells A that oldest child plays piano. So cannot be three years of age. So it has to be something bigger. So how old are three children? Tell me. In the possibilities of having 36, possibilities of having 36 is once 1 1 36, 1 2 18, 1 3 12, 1 4 9, 1 6 6, 2 2 9, 2 3 6, 2 3 3 4. Okay, is that clear? So how about the sum? The problem here is when A replies another clue is needed, that means there must be two cases, at least two cases, that gives the same solution. Let's come back to this. 1 1, I am adding these. 1 1, 36, 38, 1 2 18, 21, 1 3 12, 16, the sum. 1 4 9, 14, 1 6 6, 13, 2 2 9, 13, 3 2 6, 11, 3 3 4, 10. The oldest child plays piano is this. It has to be either one. in the problem because A said another clue is needed. If it was, for example, 11, if the sum was 11, A wouldn't tell that another clue was needed. Since A says another clue is needed, that means there must be equal summations among solutions. So think about how we thought about it. We laid out possible solutions and selected among them. We can write an algorithm for this, for example. So in human brain, we try to model the problem with the previously learned problems. We try to match them to previously learned problems, and remembering of the solution of the previously learned problems, including addition, multiplication, subtraction, including those basic operations, we try to solve the problem that we are facing. So your brain now worked all those steps. Iteration, it has iteration, it has checking, equality testing, everything is used now. So this is Python code from the book, new edition of the book. Search algorithm, trying to find whether there is something in a given list. Trying to find the target value in a given list or function. If the list is empty, exit. If the list is not empty, because it can be empty. If you start searching an empty list, you may say that it is not found, but the list is empty. So it's actually an error. And if your algorithm tries to get the first element by default, if there is no first element, your program will crash because there is no memory. There will be no memory associated with the first element. So it is better to check in those cases whether you have something or whether there is nothing in your hand. Therefore, you have a list is empty control at the beginning. It's important. It will be your nightmare later in your life. If you forget these kind of things, these kind of checkings, eventually you will have problems. The idea is there is a list. Get the element, compare with what I have. If it is the one I have, say I'm done with it. If not, continue. So check the next element, check the next element, check the next element. If they are equal, you say found. If they are not equal, didn't found. So if you reach to the end, that means you couldn't found any. So while there is a loop from beginning to end for all the entries, select the next entry as a test entry. Target value and test entry are compared. If they are equal, you say, I found it. Otherwise, didn't find it. So check one by one. You are searching for the word, for example, Gebze in Google. How it is done? Is Google try to look for Gebze in all documents in your after your query? No. So how it is done? It was searched before. It was searched before given with the name Gebze, because Gebze is a word found in documents. When you search for Gebze, the most significant elements are sorted in advance. Those where the word Gebze is occurring very frequently comes first. So there is a list containing Gebze. That list comes up. And the location of that list is automatically determined by a function computed by Google, simple function computed by Google, and it automatically redirects the word Gebze to that list. So the solution is pre-computed, maybe, usually. If you search for something something not indexed, that we call it indexing, something not indexed, then the system cannot find it. It has to index it. Therefore, for example, you cannot search for letter A in Google. Letter A cannot be searched. It has to be a word size. If it is the word size, then the algorithm automatically redirects you to a pre-computed list of pages. So there is a sorting going on because most relevant ones should be at the top. But that is in the documents. So Google indexes documents based on the words found in documents, not based on the searches. In the books, there is an index page. Bakıyor. Türkçe'de kaç kelime var? 30.000. 30.000 tane index yapıyor. Sen Gebze ararsan, Gebze'nin geçtiği listeyi sana dönüyor.
30.000 kelimeyle kombinasyonlar
veriyor. O zaman o fonksiyonlar içerisinde işlem yapıyor. O listeler içerisinde işlem yapıyor işte. O zaman yapıyor. Bulamıyor. Yanlışı düzeltme algoritması var bir de. Elindeki kelimeleri bulamadığı zaman acaba yanlış mı yazdıya düşüyor fonksiyon. O zaman bir tanesini değiştirip bakıyor. Zaten o şekilde çalışıyor sistem. İşte Gebze değil de Gebze yaz. O acaba Gebze demek istemişsinizdir. Ben Gebze'yi gösteriyorum diyor hatta, dikkat ederseniz.
Gebze'ye gelene kadar tüm kelimeleri bakıyor mu Gebze'ye gelmek?
O anda bakmıyor. Soru çok güzel. Cevabı da güzel. Şimdi G'nin ASCII karşılığı kaç? Salla kafadan. 107. Değil mi? E'nin 105. FG yok. FG 105. Ama atıyorum şu anda bilmediğim. Böyle bu sayıları 107 çarpı 3 artı 105 çarpı 8 artı bilmem ne diye bir sayı elde ediyor bu. Tamam mı? Bir fonksiyonla. Ne olduğu çok önemli değil. Bir tane 3572 65 14 diye bir tane sayı elde ediyor bu Gebze'den. Sen Gebze'ye girer girmez. Tamam mı? Bu da adamın hard diskinde cluster tabii bu. Hard diskimde bu isimde bir file var. Tak oraya gidiyor.
Bu yüzden bu kadar uzun.
Evet.
Ben yeni bir site açtım Gebze.
Sürekli travel ediyor Gebze'nin Google'ın robotu. Oraya gidiyor. Buradaki listeyi güncelliyor devamlı. Şu site daha yukarıda, bu site aşağıda. O yüzden Search Engine Optimization dedikleri şey, o şeyleri ayarlayarak sitelerde bol bol içinde Gebze çok seviyoruz Gebze şöyle. Gebze arayınca sen geliyorsun bu sefer. Çok fazla geçmiş oluyor.
Bazı şeyler çarpması
yok. Her kelime ayrı yere gitsin. Her kelime ayrı yere gitsin anlamı taşıyan bir fonksiyon. Hash fonksiyonu kısaca. Yani Gebze'den Ahmet çıkıyor. Darıca'dan Mehmet çıkıyor. Darıca'dan da Ahmet çıkmaması lazım ki iki dosya üst üste gelmesin.
Şimdi bu sayıyı bulup bir sürü sayı arasından bakıyor.
Hayır, bakmıyor işte. Tak gidiyor oraya. Çünkü daha önce yapmış. Evet, öyle bir şey. Evet. Sadece o listeler üzerinde işlem yapıyor. Kitapların arkasında indeks sayfaları vardır. İndeks sayfalarında o kelimenin hangi sayfalarda geçtiğinin numarası yazar. Klasik indeks. İşte o indexing. Bu nerelerde, hangi web sitelerinde geçiyor şeklinde bir indexing var. Hangi kelimelerin? Kitapta geçen kelimelerin. Tabii kitaptaki indekste şeyi yazmazlar dikkat ederseniz. Ve hangi sayfalarda geçiyor yazmaz. Çünkü o önemli değil. Ama mesela İzmir nerede geçiyor yazar. Veya bir tarih kitabıysa işte Sultan Süleyman nerede geçiyor yazar. Ama geldi, hangi sayfalarda geldi yazıyor yazmaz. Onu indekslemez. Tabii Google olunca, bilgisayar olunca hepsini yapabiliyor. İndekslenmesi gerekiyor yani önceden. Ve sonradan o indeksin ucuna şak diye ulaşabilmen gerekiyor. Sen aradığında tek tek bakmak o şey olacak iş değil yani. Bir processing yapıyor tabii de arama prosesi yapmıyor. Evet. Arama prosesi yapmıyor. Arama prosesinin adına indeksleme deniyor. Google indeksliyor falan deniyor. İşte database index deniyor diyor mesela. İndeksleme demek şu. Bir mağazaya gittiniz. Türkçe'ye geçtim ama anlamayan varsa söylesin. Bir mağazaya gittiniz. Parça söylüyorsunuz. Bana diyorsunuz. Ekran şu isimli ekran kartı lazım. Kocaman bir dükkan. Tamam abi bakayım var mı diye tam eleman gidiyor. Bütün malları kontrol ediyor mu? Acaba bu mu diye. Ne yapıyor? Bir deftere yazmışlar. Şu markalı kartlar şu rafta, şu markalı kartlar şu rafta diye yazmışlar. Önce o deftere bakıyor indeks. O defterden bu kartlar burada gidiyor oradan alıyor. Aynı şekilde yani.
O zaman bir şey demek oluyor mu?
Ama şey olursa, hurdacı olursa şu parçadan var mı diye gittin o zaman hepsini sırayla bakması lazım. Çünkü indeks yok adamda veya kafasında hatırlıyor işte bir şekilde.
Google'da açtığımız bir siteyi o zaman biz Yandex'te bulamayacak
mısınız? Yandex'te kendi başına gene kendi indeksini kendi yapıyor.
Tamam yani biz Google'da bir internet sayfası açmışsak bunu Yandex'te bulamayacak mısınız?
Bulursun. Bulursun.
Bunu Google kendi adreslerine kaydetmiyor
mu? Yandex'te kendi adresine kaydediyor.
Benim Google'da yaptığım şey Yandex'e nasıl kaydediyor?
Açıksa dünyaya dolaşıyor. Linklerden dolaşıyor zaten. Ya da sen submit ediyorsun seni. So this is interesting. A sorting problem. Instead of searching, now we have sorting. Sorting problem with five names. five names. Fortunately, the example is from the book and the names are not Turkish. Names are American. So Alex, Fred, Diana, Byron, Carol. As a principle, what is my destination? In the destination, it has to have Fred. No. It has to have Alex, Byron, Carol, Diana, and Fred. So I have to convert this array or list, same thing, to the desired form. I am going to replace it. One idea. Second idea, I am going to create another one, another list. I am going to find the smallest one. Who is the smallest one? Alex. I am going to find the smallest one and copy the smallest one at the top. Find this, erase the smallest one. When I erase the smallest one, what will be the smallest one again? The next smallest one will be the smallest one. Copy that as a second element. So one strategy in this kind of problems is generate an empty place, pick desired elements by searching. Pick the smallest one, pick the second smallest one, pick the third smallest one, pick the etc. When you pick the first smallest one and copy, one idea is erase it so that the smallest one will make it 9999 so that the smallest one will be the next one. Another algorithm, another strategy is swapping them in their locations so that you don't need the second list. That is better. So having a second list is not a good, clever solution. It is a poor student solution. But it works. Sometimes in some problems, you don't want to touch that original database. Maybe you don't have a write permission. It is someone else's table in the database. So copying is one idea, but in this problem, no. So you need to replace it. When you are replacing two things, you cannot replace at the same time because you are a computer. What you do is take this to a variable, take this to a variable in this memory, put this in here, put this in here. So it's four steps, right? So there is no direct swapping. Algorithmically, we say swap, but practically, read, copy, read, put. So that will be the solution. So Fred, Alex, Diana, Byron first. My idea is let me replace it. Let me start replacing it and see what happens. Fred, Alex, that's not correct. Alex must become first, then Fred. So replace it. Take the Alex out. Save it somewhere in register or memory. Push the Fred down again by read and write in the CPU in your program. Then write the Alex back. So that is a swapping. First line here is a swapping Alex and Fred. Second, Alex, Fred, is that okay? Good, fine, no problem. Alex, Fred, Diana. No, Diana is incorrect. Diana must be first. So swap Diana and Fred. Then Alex, Diana, Fred. Oops, Byron. Byron and Fred is incorrect. Alex, Diana, Fred. Correct. But Alex, Diana, Fred, Byron, incorrect. Not sorted. So let me take care of Byron. Take the Byron out. Where? After Byron. After Alex. And Diana and Fred will be shifted down. It may sound simple, but it is not. Because you need to take two guys one by one to the end. Then Carol. Carol must be again taken up. So Carol is put on top. At the end, your array is sorted. So it's not a good, it's not an easy task. You need to understand, check the order. If the order is not correct, who is making it incorrect, and take the incorrect one to the correct position. That's what sorting is. Any questions? Let's give a yeah. Aslında karşılaştırıyor. Yani direkt aşağı indirmek kolay, yani öyle bir şey yok. Burada kısa kesmiş. Let's give a break and come back in 5 minutes. Çok güzel bir anlaşma yapacağız inşallah. Türkiye Finans Katılım Bankası, söyledim mi ben size? Türkiye Finans Katılım Bankası ile Kartal'da Teknopark kuruyoruz.
Nerede?
Kartal Adnan Kahveci Grand'da.
Abi bizim orada.
Şeyin binasını biliyor musun? Doğuş'un arkasında Türkiye Finans Bankası vardı.
Abi, E5'in şeyin
kenarında. Tam o üst geçit var ya bir tane.
Evet.
Onun arkasında. Abi çok. O binaya el koyma operasyonu yapacağız.
Umarım hocam.
İnşallah olur. Yani İnşallah. Bakanlıktan tabii her şey olabilir. Beklenir de. Olursa çok.
Ne demiştiniz? Tam olarak ne yapacağız?
Finans Teknoparkı. Bizim öğrencilerin işte çalışabileceği, şey yapabileceği. İstanbul'un finans şirketlerinin toplanacağı. Bankacılıkla ilgili teknoloji firmaları orada yer alacak. İnşallah olur. Onunla ilgili mesaj gelmişti.
Hocam bir soru vardı. ODV hakkında.
Söyle.
Ben katılıyorum da ODV.
Ne?
Ayrıca.
Hangi ülkedensin?
Afganistan.
Afganistan'dan geldi. Hangi şehir?
Tamam.
Başka şehir yok zaten diyorsun. Ne zaman geldin?
Kayıt için. Kaydımı dün yaptım.
Ha, dün yaptım. Peki Türkiye, okula ne zaman başladın? Yeni mi başladın?
Evet.
Dersler Teams sisteminde var. Teams sisteminde bir kere öğrenci hesabın ile kayıt olacaksın. Orada kayıtlı dersler var. O kayıtlı dersleri dinleyeceksin. Recordingleri var. Ödev konusunda da ödevini yap, yükle. Senin kaydın geç olduğu için sen bir şekilde gönderirsin bize. Hani
oraya kadar gelsen ödev şey değil. O kadar sorun değil. Sen esas dersleri geçebilecek misin? Önemli olan o. Epeyce bir zaman geçti. Yani bir şekilde idare edeceksin. İngilizcen nasıl?
İyi.
İyi, tamam. Okay.
Web sitesine link çalışıyor mu?
Ha?
Web sitesine link çalışıyor mu?
Hangi link? 101 link. Çalışıyor.
Aa, tamam. Ben Teams'den bulursam göndereyim.
Teams'den bulursan gönder dersin evet, linki abi. Diye. Ha, onu gönder. O şekilde olur. Olmadı bana mail atarsın, tamam mı? Şey, ben tıkladım da çalışıyordu. Niye çalışmasın ki? Çalışması lazım. Çalışmıyorsa haberim olsun. Giremezsin. Tamam. İki ay oldu. Dur. Durum zor yani.
Bizim için biraz oluyor. Kendi onu orada
mı? Yani. Her sene adam bırakıyoruz yani. Öyle herkes geçmiyor. Böyle şirin davranıyorum işte size falan ama hani bırakıyoruz yani.
Kayıt devam ediyor hocam.
Kötü bir şey söyleyeyim mi? Ya benim bırakmam da şundan kaynaklanıyor. Sınıfta normalde bir çan eğrisi dağılımı illaki oluyor. Altta kalanlar tabii kalıyor yani.
Çan
erisi. Tabi. Çan erisi yapmasak riskli olur. Daha çok kişi kalır.
Ama bu sefer de kesinlikle birileri kalmış
olur yani. Yok öyle değil. Kesinlikle birileri kalması istatistiksel bir sonuç. Mesela derse hiç gelmeyip de gelmeyecek olan en az 20 kişi var.
Ya mesela şöyle herkes
çok her sene de öyle oluyor yani. Şimdi olmaz demiyorsun. İlla ki adam gelmiyor. İlla ki adam aşık oluyor. İlla ki çalışmıyor. Yani şeye, istatistiğe baktığın zaman mahallenin illa ki bir delisi çıkıyor yani.
Herkes çok iyi yapsa mesela o çok iyi yapanların kötüleri yine kalmayacak mı?
Hayır, kalmaz. Ama yapmıyorlar. O çan eğrisi bazen böyle çan şeklinde olmaz da üçgen şeklinde olur. Yani bir tarafı iyi olabilir. Siz böyle şey Bedir'in aslanları gibi çalışırsanız o zaman olur yani. Matematikler nasıl gidiyor? Temel dersler.
Fizik ders.
Ne anlatıyorlar fizikte şu an?
Newtonyası.
Projectile atış, eğik atış falan mı?
Geçti.
Şey yaptınız mı?
Hareket bitti.
Karıştırılan şey, tamam. Karıştırılan çayın yüzeyini hesaplayabiliyor musunuz? Şey. Çay karıştırıyorsun. Dönme hızı var. Dakikada işte şunu da karıştırıyorsun. Kaç santim aşağı düşer şeyi?
Ortası.
Neye göre?
Yok,
da öyle bir şey.
Göre? Merkez kaç kuvvetiyle ağırlığı yerde G var. Bu tarafta da merkez kaç kuvveti var. İkisinin dengeli durduğu şeyi eğride duruyor.
Bunu ip üzerinde yaptık. O zaman
ipten de
hesaplayabiliriz
bunu. Evet, iple aynı. Başka ne var? Eğik atış var. Rotational. Inertia biraz. Moment, inertia ve momentum biraz şey yapar. Kafa karıştırır bazılarınızı. Momentum'da hakikaten böyle mi falan gibi düşündüğünüz olabilir.
Bunlar lise konusu var. Zaten biz bunları bilerek geldik.
Evet. İşte biraz, biraz geniş anlat. Şu var. Lisede bunların daha basit anlatılması lazım. Lisede sizi çok fazla yüklüyorlar. Gereksiz. Burada da biraz daha yüksek anlatılması lazım.
Şu an liseyle eşit sadece virgüllü sayılar kullanıyoruz. Ama işte bir de şeyleri bulmamız gerekiyor. Terimlerin İngilizcesini falan.
Ya evet arası şey olur ama kitap ne fizikte? Halliday Nezdik mi?
O değil.
Friedman.
Young Friedman.
Kitaplar yani güzel şeyler var. elektromanyetizmaya falan geçince biraz daha şey renklenir, optik moptik.
Oraya kadar gelecek miyiz? Fizik bir de.
Bir de gelmezsiniz. Deney yapılıyor mu? Evet, bu var mı? Ne yaptınız?
Yani en son bir şey yaptım.
Şey var mı?
Freefall yapmıştım. Max Verstappen yaptı. Dönüp aşağıya.
Gerçek deneyim yapıyorsunuz tabii.
Gerçek. Ölçüm vesaire hepsini. Ama işte fiziğin uygulaması o biraz kötü oluyor.
Fiziğin uygulaması elektronik.
Yok yani derste işlediğimiz anlatılmıyor. Yani online derste.
Yani işte bisikletten düşünce ne kadar yaralanıyorum ona bakacaksın. Hızlı gidersen çok yaralanıyorsun.
Evet işte vizede biraz öyle çekiliyor.
Başka ne var? İşte motosiklet kullanırsan yoldan çıkıyorsun falan. Friction, friction oradan.
Bir şey başka soru çözüm falan mı? Yok işte öyle bir şey. Olsa güzel. Yok senin için aynı matematik değil. Aynı öyle bir şey olsa.
Bende bir video seti var. Kaliforniya Üniversitesi'nin. 52 tane videosu var. Onu size ben bir şekilde vereyim de. Onu şey yapın. Kendi aranızda dinleyin.
Konu
anlatıyor.
İyi ya. Dersiniz sorun şu oluyor işte konudan ziyade soru çözüm. Mesela
niye? Nasıl olsa geçeceksin.
Ama hani ders anlamayınca gidip gidiyorsunuz izleyebiliyoruz ama hocalar biraz soru çözüm üstüne dökünce daha rahat olur.
Bir de bizim durum çok şey değil
ki. Şöyle oluyor bak amaç soru çözmeye dönüşünce soru çözmeyi iyi biliyorsun konuyu anlamıyorsun. O da doğru değil yani. Amaç burada soru çözmek değil ki. Soru çözmek ölçme metodu.
Öyle zaten ama matematikte bu ikisi beraber destekleniyor.
Matematik evet.
Ama fizikte yapılmıyor. Sadece konu anlatımıyla alakalı. Bu sefer de soru üstünde.
Fizikte peki şey yok mu? Problem session yok mu? Bize şey yaparlardı. Asistanlara akşam 5'ten sonra birer saat.
İşte o matematikte yapılıyor. Ha. İşte matematikte yapılıyor. Fizikte yapılıyor.
Yapsınlar. Direktöre gidin. Rektör fizikçi. Asarlar. Sonuçta eğitim ya. Siz izleyicinize hani, ücret vermeyecek
mi? Yani mesela ben isterim başka. Fizikten fazladan bir ders
olacak. İsteyenlere?
Çoğunluk falan.
Gider çoğunluk gider. Şan eğrisine göre ben yani tecrübem giderler. Sonuçta asistan problem çözüyor. Niye gitmeyeceksin? Gidersin. Çıkışında köfteciye gidersin. Yani onun bir sosyalizasyon şeyi de var ders dışında. So.
Sen bugün boş. Pardon, cuma.
Sorting algorithms. Sorting algorithms are interesting. There are different sorting algorithms and each sorting algorithm has different properties. One of them is bubble sort, one of them is insertion sort, another one is merge sort, another one is linear sort. Okay? There are different sorting algorithms. And each of them has different advantages and disadvantages. This one is called as insertion sort. Insertion sort means finding an element, taking it out, and putting the correct one in correct place. Such as, start with two elements. In order to sort an array, something, you need to at least two things. If you have one thing, there is no need for sorting. So start with two. One case is there might be out of order, they might be in order. If they are in order, no need to do anything. If they are out of order, you will swap, replace the locations. So start with n equals to two. While there is a loop, you will iterate until the end of the list. So from beginning to end, you will iterate, starting with 2, 0, 1, 2. Pivot is the end. This is pivot. Second. Take it out. Take it out. When you take it out, there is an element at the top, above. There is an entry above the hole. And if entry is greater than pivot, if they are out of order, push this down. Push the one that is above the entry, in this case, the second. And move the pivot back to the hole. That is what swap is. Take one element out. If they are out of order, swap. If they are not out of order, put it back. Take out of order, swap. Now put it back. Is that clear? Do it. Increment the end. Increment the end and go back. Increment the end, go back for n equals to 2. And there is another while here. Because swapping incorrectly aligned pairs, is not sufficient. You have to do this for every n. Therefore, you have to go through twice, not twice, but n times n times. At worst, if everything is incorrect, inner while will repeat n times, outer while will repeat another n times. And then at the end, it will be sorted. Sorted. Any questions? Since this is Python language, this while and this is here, so they are in the same level. Swap, check, swap, check, swap, check. If you are satisfied, then the problem is correct. That's how you develop an algorithm. Second important thing is the recursion. Recursion is a kind of chicken and egg problem. Chicken is born from egg, and egg is also laid by chicken. Recursion means the function calls itself. Such as the famous recursion algorithm is famous recursion algorithm is as follows. How do you calculate n factorial? N factorial is actually n times n minus 1 times 2 times 1, right? That's what n factorial is. And another definition is n factorial is equal to n times n minus 1 factorial. Is that clear? So this is a recursive definition. Definition. That's what recursion is coming from, recursive definition. Let's say int factorial, int factorial, int k. A function definition. I skip declaration and main program. Back to you. I say if k equals to 1, return 1. Else, return. Else, return. Fact. K minus 1. Yeah. Sorry. Gördüğünüz gibi hata yaptık. Kontrol. El yazısıyla şey yapıyoruz. If k equals to 1, return. Else, return factorial k minus 1. So, this is factorial. The function name is also factorial. So it calls itself until you go back to 1. If you don't have this kind of stopping mechanism, your program will run forever or crash. So these kind of recursive algorithms should have a terminating, should have an ending condition, such as if k equals to 1, because I am expecting that k will be 1 at some time. And if k is 1, then it will first return 1, then 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and up to n. And the main program, for example, in the void main, you have m equals factorial 180. So that kind of call can happen. So in that case, factorial 180 is called. It will first compute, it will first call factorial 180, then 179, 178, 177. Oh, I'm sorry. Times k. Okay. So it will start multiplying. It will start multiplying. Çarpı k, n çarpı n eksi 1 ya, k çarpı k eksi 1 olması lazım. Olarak. Çarpı yıldız, evet. It will go back to 1 and then collect everything up to 180 automatically. The problem is, remember CPU is working as an ustabaşı mechanic guy working on one car. when the function is called, he switched to another car because of something else. In this case, you switch to another car, switch to another car, switch to another car. How many times? 180 times. And until at the very last part, if k equals to 1, he found, okay, this is the thing I wanted. Then he has to travel all the way back to all the cars to answer the first question. In that case, the mechanic guy should remember which was the previous car, where was the previous car. So he has to remember the return address. In here, you have 180 return addresses. One function calls itself, one function calls itself, itself, itself, itself. How many times? 180 times. But if you have factorial 1 million, it's too much. So recursive algorithms are very heavy on computer memory because it calls itself, itself, itself. If the upper number is a significantly big number, your algorithm has a heavy impact on computer memory because the return addresses must be put on stack memory. Should be remembered. There must be a mechanism to remember. If you are doing multiplication in the while loop, for example, you don't need to remember anything. You just need to remember the previous number, previous multiplication. No problem. But if you are using this kind of recursive approach, algorithmically it is nice, but memory-wise, it is sometimes very heavy. Is that clear? Algorithmically, it is easy to formulate the problem. Sometimes, for example, this formula is very nice. So when you do recursive computations such as fact k minus one times k, same thing. That is easy to understand, easy to formulate, a simple program. But computer calls itself, itself, itself, itself, itself. So it is like a pyramid. You are trying to reach the top and then bottom again. You need to save all these intermediate steps. So when the size of iteration is not big, it can work very well. If the size of iteration gets very big, then your computer memory may not be sufficient enough. So you need to change your algorithm in that case. Yeah. Main program calls factorial 180. Because I am interested in the factorial value of 180. So one idea is I can make a counter from 1 to 180, and I can define a temporary variable. Temporary variable equals to temporary times counter. And in the counter, in the while loop, until counter finishes, I keep multiplying. That's doable and gives me the result. But here, my formula says factorial can be computed by multiplying the number with the factorial of the number minus 1. Number minus 1 factorial can be computed using the same function. So function can call itself. If the function is calling itself all the time, what happens? It will run forever. So there must be a limiting point. That point is because since you are subtracting 1 all the time, you reach 1 or 0 in some other problems. So there is an end. If you reach to the end, then you say return without calling itself anymore. Don't call itself anymore. return immediately. But if you are not satisfied with the result, if the k is not one yet, then call factorial function itself by itself so that it will reach to, it will move to one, counting down from 180 to 1. Yeah, because it is this one at the top. This one is return one. Each one will return 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. And then it will keep collecting it from the bottom, and at the top, the result will come back to variable m. So recursive sorting can be implemented too. Alice, Bob, Carol, David, Elaine, Fred, George, Harry, Irene, John, Kerry, Larry, Mary, Nancy, Oliver. Search. I am searching John. It is sorted. Assume that we have sorted, and we are trying to find whether who John is in the list. Searching problem. Google search'e yakındır bu. Tam değil ama. One idea is check why I is less than n, check all of them. And if name is equal to John, something like that. So check each one, right? Is that possible? Yes. But what am I doing here? If I sort the list first, I have an advantage. I can pick the number at the in the middle. I can pick the name in the middle, number in the middle, doesn't matter. I can compare it with John. If the John is equal to Harry, if there is John here, I say I found it. No problem, because it is in the middle. If it is not John, no, it is Harry. Is that clear? It is Harry. Which one is bigger? Harry bigger or John bigger? John is bigger. Therefore, I will conclude that this part cannot be the result, because John is bigger than Harry. Because it is sorted. Then I will take the mid number in the next part, my second problem. My second problem is similar to my first problem, just like in the factorial. Second problem is very similar. Take the one in the middle, compare it. Which one is bigger? Larry is bigger. So this part is redundant. It is probably, if exists, it is probably here. Check the middle one. I found it. I was looking for Kelly. If I was looking for Kelly, I will have another step. Is it better than searching one by one? really better. For 1,000 elements, let's say not 1,000. For this kind of names, 4,096 elements, names. How many comparisons I need to make using standard approach? 4,096 comparisons needs to be done, right? If I am going to use this algorithm, how many comparisons I need to make maximum? 12 versus 496. It's too big. The difference is significant. Bazı mağazalarda insanlar işte elbise karıştırırlar, sırayla bakarlar. Hepsine teker teker bakarlar aradığı pantolonu bulmak için. Bu işte öyle. Bir üsttekine bakacaksın. Ortadaki even odd olabilir. Yani 3 tane olmayıp da 2 tane de olabilir burada. O zaman bir üsttekidir ortadaki. O önemli değil. This is called as binary search. And what is the relation between 4,096 and 12? So, what is the relation then? Mathematical relation. It is the log. Log base 2, 4,096 is 12. So the complexity, we say complexity, algorithm complexity is 4,000 log n. That's big O. Meaning it could go up to log n. It could be earlier. It could be shorter. But at most, I will go to log n. So the complexity is considered as log n. In the first method, for example, if John is here, if John is at the first element, it takes only one comparison to find it. Is it explaining anything? No, it can be because it is for special case, not generalized solution. For the generalized solution, the worst case scenario is 4,096. So we say complexity is O-N, O not, big O notation.
Base 2.
Yeah, in base 2. In computer algorithmic complexity problems, it's always base 2 because I'm talking about binary structure. It is due to binary structure, binary tree structure. Therefore, it is base 2. So this thing coded, if the target value is equal, I found it. If the target value is the other side, less than, look one side. If it is on the other side, look to the right side. Left side or right side. And at each case, call itself. Call itself for the remaining half. Remaining half is also another list. So when you have a list of 4,096 elements, how many times the recursive algorithm, will call itself maximum 12. At most 12 times the algorithm will finish. So 12 or those kind of numbers are tolerable, nice numbers for computer applications. So recursive algorithm, that kind of recursive algorithm does not give heavy memory use for the computer. So it is okay. Still, when you are using recursive algorithms, please be careful. Please be careful so that it ends. It may not end. Same algorithm. Same algorithm. These are for later studying for you. It does what we have explained in the code comparison with the previous one, the next one. And if it is on the next part, then look for this part. If you find it, say, I found it, and so on. Yeah. Sorting, first insertion sort, checking, requires n times n operations. When you have a while loop going up to n, another while loop going up to n, that means if this is the size of the list, then your complexity is set O n square. If you have only one while loop, if you can eliminate this while loop with certain number of operations, certain given number of operations independent from n, then it becomes O n. If this is terminating due to recursive approach, due to binary approach, in a log complexity way, in recursive algorithm, then it will be O n log n. Obviously, n log n is much smaller than n square. So n square is, some algorithms require O n cube. Very heavy algorithms, three while loops inside each other. For small numbers, we can solve it, but for big numbers, it is very difficult. Undoable problems. For example, it takes 1 week to compute something. So if it's an interactive problem, that means you can't do it. So by analyzing the problem in better way, for example, in sorting, you may find better algorithms, but there is a limit, theoretical limit for certain problems. For example, sorting cannot be done in ON. You cannot sort an array in ON steps. Impossible. With a sequential look. It could be n log n, but it cannot be n. If you are bad, it could be n cube, n to the 4. Lazy programmers, code works slower. That's the worst case scenario. Lazy sort is the insertion sort. Let's stop here. And if you have questions, I will be answering. Let me stop recording. Hold on.